Call the meeting to order at 7:17 PM. Do we want to do introductions? Elaine Campbell, School Committee Vice Chair, Conway.
Judy Siciliano, Principal.
Patty Kavanaugh, Director of Business Services.
Marty Barrett, Superintendent.
Carl Anderson, School Committee.
Phil Cantor, Member.
Ira Ben, Member.
And Jan Warner, our chair, is unable to be here this evening. So first off, we need to vote on our minutes of April 7th.
Motion to approve the minutes of April 7th.
Seconded.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
All righty. Financial statements?
Okay, you have before you. We'll start with the warrants. You have six warrants to sign tonight that total $31,038.32. Judy, did you bring the lunch warrant?
Yes, I
did. Oh, okay, great, thank you. Your financial report for April is also attached. And one thing I do want to bring to your attention is on the bottom of page one, I have encumbered the retiring principal's sick pay buyback. So that we will.
Oh, God, we have to buy that back?
Yes,
from her?
And she never took a sick day. God love her. So.
This is on national television.
National?
International.
International.
Could be. So we'll be able to pay for that from electricity savings, and our the fuel adjustment clause in our busing has saved us to date $10,544. So I am not. I'm not concerned that we will not, you know, finish the year in the black. I just want to bring it to your attention that we did encumber it. And then on page two, we're running over in the school choice, and we'll know what we're, I'll know better as we get closer to the end of the year if we have money to make that zero so that we don't spend into next year's funds. So I'll be watching that as well. That's all I have, unless anyone has any questions.
Are we looking at having other extra funds that we need to spend down before the...
I won't know that till we get closer to next month.
Okay.
And then I will talk with the principal. Oh, I do know that we're going to have one other expenditure. I believe we talked about it at the last meeting. It is the principal's wish that if we do anything first is to buy the new principal new office furniture.
Oh, right.
And I believe you all agreed with that. Yeah. And the new principal will be coming to visit. And Wednesday, so she will. You have the catalog, okay. Do you want Baker Supply to come up, maybe, or
if you think
so, they can measure it?
She get it, Walt will come.
Hey, you started.
Fancy.
You started. We can talk about it offline.
But the decor still has to match the view of the cows out the window.
Right. Country decor. Okay. Any other financial questions? Onward. Warrants are set. Any public comment? No public. Unfinished business. I don't believe we have any, so we're on to new business. And we have policies. Marty?
I tried to pass these out to the Whately School Committee, and they didn't want to take them. So I'm offering them to you. Basically, Ira is our rep on our policy subcommittee. We have policies D through J to vote on tonight. Tomorrow night we will complete L and K, and we are done.
Wow.
The entire policy book is revamped and will be online. I sort of like Don's suggestion at the joint meeting back in April when he said the policy subcommittee has worked very hard on this and that school committee will take their recommendation. Their recommendation is that you approve policies D through J tonight. But if you would like a copy.
Start reading.
Yeah, start reading, Pearl.
Let us know what you're done.
Yeah.
Oh, I could say firsthand they were done diligently with a lot of meetings. And I look forward to being on the policy committee next year.
Because yes. It'll be a piece of cake.
There will be a policy committee.
That's why he's going to join it.
Wow.
Count him in.
Yeah. Well, I know the new superintendent expressed her gratitude that she was at the meeting, at the Frontier meeting.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
I said she owes Marty a lot of cookies.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah. So...
It was an important thing to do.
You could have dodged
tedious,
it so easily,
but
Marty,
it really
so.
Is important, and right. So I'm glad we did it. And
it's impressive.
And I'm glad that it's almost finished.
Yeah.
So.
That's
great. Well, thank you for your hard work, Ira and Marty.
Thank you.
Yes, absolutely.
Is the mask woman still showing up at each one of these?
Yeah.
And her assistant. Sometimes.
And her assistant. Yeah.
Most of the time.
Is it? So. She's retiring too. Right?
Yeah.
It's a good question.
I didn't make that request.
I think it's a nice desk I have.
She gave her policy book instead. You
I'm
gave
leaving
her furniture.
Her,
she gave her a new
I'm
policy
leaving her
book.
My lamp. And my chair.
I wanted that.
Can we vote them all together
yes.
in one big clump?
Yes, you can vote this approved policy sections D through J.
So can I get a motion to approve policies D through J?
I'm
sure.
Yeah,
I'll second that.
I move we approve as submitted.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Take it home for some good nighttime reading.
Well, actually, you can't take it home. Oh. Donna said that I could pass them out tonight, but I must. Bring them back.
Be able to read
to
it
peruse
now.
In between conversations.
That was a really pointless idea. That
you know, it was.
It's
because
a symbolic act.
I realized that it was a lot of effort to get these and bring these back.
Wow.
It's a showing of evidence.
You
not
know what,
to mention
Bill,
the fear of physical labor.
You might actually read it, so mm-hmm. you take a copy. Ira will autograph it for you.
Yeah.
There you go.
To fill with love.
Yes.
I'll wait till it's on the website.
Thank you. It's probably
you must have trouble sleeping, so that will help, I guess.
So that was approved for?
Approved.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. On to the teacher's agreement.
The teacher's agreement, I pass those out to you. So the front section is the teachers, and the back section is the instructional assistants. Phil was our diligent representative for this negotiations group. I will tell you that it was a very lengthy negotiations for the teachers. We started in October and we didn't finish until the end of March.
I would like to ask you for your thoughts about that, about the length of it, and about lessons maybe for next time to pass on to the new driver.
I told the Whately School Committee, I thought it was interesting because honestly it was my first contract negotiation. Except for Bob Holla, everybody on the committee, or were you on the other one?
Yeah, I was on the other one.
Okay, so we had two people who had been on others, but everybody else was new. And we had two separate attorneys, but who were both new to us, two brothers. And the elementary teachers' negotiation was extremely lengthy, and I thought it was not a fault of the teachers, but it was who represented the teachers. And the others have gone very quickly, and the others all have had different MTA representation, consistent, the same person, but not the same as the teachers. So they came in, and I asking for a lot, and we ended up reaching an agreement, but we gave very little of any financial consequence to the district. But I really, and I don't know how you feel about this, Phil, but I felt that most of the things that were asked for by the attorney and not our teachers.
And, okay, I think that our own attorney was not as much at fault in the
mm-hmm.
delaying thing as the other one, but was up there in responsibility. And I think that we're in a situation where both of our representatives have agendas that don't always dovetail with our own. that they have larger statewide agendas for that they perceive statewide significance in certain clauses that we ourselves and the union do not attach any significance to.
Correct.
And
I
so
agree.
And so we ourselves could come to an agreement like that, but we're being prevented by our attorneys who each have a point to prove using us. And that there was one thing in particular, one clause, and I talk about this generally so it's okay to talk about, and that is and it was really something that held up for weeks. And it was a clause in the contract that involved an unsettled area of law where the state has passed the law, but there's not yet any case law or any interpretation of what that law means. So each attorney had their own sense of what the law should mean. And we were sort of in the place where we didn't really, neither side really cared what the law meant, and it wasn't even that important to either one of us. But to them, especially to the union rep, this was like, and it was because in the grand scheme of things, we were one of the first ones to go through the negotiations and test this clause, but we were sort of like a test tube guinea pig kind of a thing for these lawyers to work out.
And whatever happens first is what's going to continue out throughout the state, so no one's going to move.
Right.
And that's how it was. In the end, I will tell you that Sue Siegel and I said, we probably could have negotiated this contract in 2 hours.
And
Sue and I.
Yeah. So my
last time the attorney we had, I thought was great and very efficient.
He was a very good attorney. His professional abilities. I would definitely call him back and not whatever. But he has a shop to do. You know, their representation of us involves, in their eyes, a whole statewide viewpoint.
Yeah.
Which we only barely fit into some of that stuff.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, you know, my suggestion for next time would be to start the contract out with the main prince, with the superintendent and the union head having a beer or having a cup of coffee. Seriously, beforehand.
No, I'm serious. Sue and I could have done that.
And it's something where you can shake hands, say, none of the, whatever we're about to say does not get repeated. And you just try to do what you can to advance the process, because we were sort of at the mercy and paying all along, paying both sides to work out their issues.
Right.
And I think the way it resolved, really, it didn't all come together until we stopped scheduling further meetings.
It was hours and hours. In the end, the points that were settled on is a contractual, and this is for elementary teachers, 2.5 over 3 years. We increased the head teacher's salary, which is minimal impact for the district since there's only 4 of them. We added a new pay column for those people who have masters plus 45 or CAGs. And that was about it.
To me, all that's not even as important as what we kept, which was we kept a sense of trust between the union and the administration. And we kept a sense of we're rowing the same boat on the same side. And, you know, we're not at cross purposes. It's not an us versus them.
It was a very collegial, and it was very warm, and there was a lot of handshakes and hugs at the end. I never got the sense of, I think they felt heard, and I thought our group heard them, and so I thought it was a well-done contract. The instructional assistants, their big concern was equalized pay, because it's very difficult for holiday time period, you know, to have their pay fluctuates. That was their big
during the break.
Yeah. So we negotiated that. They require now that IAs, this is not problematic, I don't think, at Conway, but it is in some of the other schools, on early release Fridays, must stay. In the past, they could leave when the kids left and take a personal day.
Okay.
But now they cannot. And that was their, the IA's request to do that. So the instructional assistant contract, I thought, went fairly quickly and fairly pleasantly. And not that the teacher wasn't unpleasant, but after about 4 or 5 months of this, it was long. So
the other thing that I'd like to specifically note is that the people that you selected to be on both of these things, those were good choices.
They were good people.
And
and
I'll just compare it with the previous contract that I was a part of. Some of the people on there, two of them at least, had an agenda to minimize pay no matter what,
right.
No matter what evidence or facts. And there was nobody on these committees with private agendas. And I think that might be an overlooked kind of a that's really important to have people, to put people on there that aren't.
No, they didn't have personal agendas. They did not have a personal preconceived idea. They were there for the good of the district. And I think they were looking out for the good.
And that's something else to pass on to this.
Right.
Because, I mean, I read the paper and there's people running Deerfield Selectmen, you know, their premise on running is I could have built the roof for $1 million instead of $3 million.
Right, right.
And I...
Really?
Yeah.
Down politics.
Down politics.
We're just one person away. One person is all it takes to really change
The
whole mood and everything else of these contracts.
Thank God the funding agreement's in place.
So we have the elementary contracts have been agreed upon and ratified. The high school instructional assistants are done. And we have a meeting Thursday for high school teachers. And hopefully that will go. We've had 3 meetings thus far, so this, I think, will be our 4th. So I'm going to be asking for a vote and ask for Elaine to sign as chair for the contracts that we have before you. Any questions that you have?
So we want to go in order of the first vote on the 2016-2019 teachers agreement?
Sure.
Okay.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 And then I ask for a vote on the ratification of the 2016-2019 instructional assistance agreement.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right. Thank you very much.
That's it for now, right?
Correct.
And now there's a vote here for the town treasurer to establish a checking account not to exceed $10,000 to be known as a student activity checking account to be operated by, so she's gonna have $10,000 slush money too? And new furniture?
Anything else? New car?
I wonder if Jan put that on.
Jan did, yeah. It's Jan.
So she'll be bold?
This is a vote that Jan put on. So I cannot elaborate.
Okay.
Oh, you don't have okay.
To be operating controlled by the Conway Grammar School principal from which funds may be expended exclusively for student purposes.
Yes, so this was something that Jan and I spoke about because right now they don't have a student activity account set up so that the principal can access the funds. It is a new state law. We put all our principals through. It's a revised state law. The principal should be the fiscal agent, not the town treasurer. So this would be the means that Judy would, from all the activities, we don't do candy sales, candle sales, whatever, would go, it'd be deposited with the treasurer, but Judy will have the ability to write the checks out as the money is dispersed.
New furniture, $10,000.
That's what I said.
Judy, you're leaving at a wrong time. Jeez.
I used to sell candy bars for
Yeah.
for the slush fund.
So I did discuss that with Jan. It is in line with the new with the legislation, and all of our schools will hopefully be going to that. And we did put our principals through a lengthy training. Remember Marty with Mark Abrahams?
Mm-hmm.
That lasted over a day.
It was lengthy.
It was lengthy. So they know the ups and the downs.
And this is
and
something
the
that only the principal can sign for, and nobody
yes,
else. And
correct.
And I'm sure
just
there'll
read
be some
the reports on cash controls and.
Right.
So I'm sure there'll be some control checks and balances
yes.
on it.
So the you're just asking to establish the account. You're not asking to deposit any monies into this account.
Well, the monies would still get deposited with the treasurer. The principal will have access to the most of $10,000. So like at Frontier, we have about $170,000in student funds, but Darius cannot write a check for more than $10,000, so it limits what they
okay.
can access at one time.
All right.
So this is so if the fifth grade raised money so that they can go to New York City, and they're going to New York City and they need a check to get into the Bronx Zoo, you can write the check for the entrance fees for the Bronx Zoo so that you could take it with you.
It makes sense.
Yeah.
I mean, we trust people with our children, we should be able to trust them with
well,
that.
Well, it absolutely makes sense, because what's been happening is that teachers have to use their own credit
right,
card.
And that gets crazy.
And then get reimbursed, and then the time it's, fashion.
It's
yeah.
just humiliating, that's all. It's
I
not even
totally
crazy, agree. It's just
right.
demoralizing and humiliating.
Well, then I think we could vote on this time.
Yes.
Okay.
I'd be happy to make it. Well, first I'll ask for a vote for the to authorize the town treasurer to establish a checking account not to exceed $10,000. I'd like to make a motion myself that we do that.
I'll second.
Great. All in favor?
Aye.
All righty. Reports.
Oh, wait. You skipped me.
Non-union salary.
Right not on there?
Non-union salary recommendations.
Oh, discussion
yes.
items.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. You're not voting on it tonight. We're just bringing
okay.
it.
So that was the page that was in color.
It has yellow.
Okay.
All right.
Sorry.
And the color piece is related to the people in the Conway building. And the second page is the administration in the central office.
Okay.
I have a question for you. I'm talking yet.
I know. I'm sorry. Yeah, that way. I saw that, and even after this year's raises, to see that we're still paying people under $12 an hour is shocking to me. And would it be possible, the person that's under $12 an hour, is it possible to bump that
okay,
up over
$12?
Okay,
that's a mistake. Okay, I'm going to talk about that.
Okay.
Okay, so.
Okay.
All right. So everyone's in here at 2% with a couple of exceptions. One, which doesn't affect our budget, is Janet Sirotico. I cannot say that name. She was hired at $55,000 a year and was promised $3,000 increase when she finished her bachelor's degree, which she did. So she's going up to $58,000. So your share is $5,800. Now this all gets paid from the tuitions. And these people down below were given a 2% raise plus a dollar because the beginning salary is $10.10.50 and the minimum wage goes up to $11 in January.
Okay.
So we're just making the dollar adjustment now. That same adjustment should have been made to Jeannie Boyden. It should say plus a dollar there. It should say $12.96
okay.
for her. Because we're also adjusting the beginning salaries of our people in the cafeteria as
okay,
well.
Good.
So she should say $12.96 an hour. Everyone else is as is. And if you look at the top, only $16.77 is what will get added to our budget. And that was budgeted for. Okay, so that's our budget will be $16.77 higher. Actually, it won't. It'll still be lower based on what our new principal's coming in at and what our old principal, there were some savings there. Although I still haven't seen the figure accounts told there were savings. On the second page is the admin.
I think it's better to say former.
Former instead of old.
Old.
We're feeling old enough, so.
Sorry, former.
What?
She said she's just about at it.
$10,000 less for new furniture, old principal. I mean, really.
If you come up with a car fund for the new principal, we're out of here. So, you know.
I'm so sorry. Current principal.
Gold American Express cards.
Yeah.
You know.
So on the admin page, everyone's at 2% with the exception of Scott Paul, and I will let Superintendent Barrett address that.
So I had this discussion with the Whately School Committee. This is an increase of 5%, and this is why I feel so strongly about this. When I did a poll of other area IT directors, he was not in line. When he started, our district technology-wise was on the precipice of going into 3x5 card system. We were
held together by rubber bands and paper clips, not kidding.
It was a disaster. He has brought us back. He has assembled a team. He has a plan to go forward. I don't want this district to lose him, and I don't think this district and central office really wants to have another centralized personnel hire. His position, I feel, affects everybody in the district more than any other central office position that I can think of. I have had other administrators come up to me and say, I will forego my raise as long as he gets a substantial increase. So I know this is sometimes difficult when you are singling out one particular person. But I really think it's a direction you need to go in. And I'm advocating because they don't have anyone to advocate for them. They don't have a union. They don't have steps. This is the only opportunity they have for increased pay.
My observation on this is that this is only ever a one-way street, that we make ourselves aware of the people that are underpaid, but we do not address the structural positions that are dramatically overpaid. And that's my take on that. It's really difficult to do that because you can't just, a title is a human being and is a person.
Mm-hmm.
But, I do a lot in the world of grants and grant writing and a grant bookkeeper. Wow, do we pay our grant bookkeeper well? We should have two grant bookkeepers for that price. We really should. And the whole idea of having that type of position as a career position instead of rotating out every 5 or 10 years and getting new sets of knowledge and new sets of contacts and new opportunities. And,
it's a bookkeeper, not a writer.
No,
not
he's
a grant
actually,
writer.
He's actually, we're saying he's a degreed accountant.
And he's our grant guy.
But I also say you have to be careful with that, Phil, because some of these people have been here 25 and 30 years. And so it's also a reflection of longevity.
And there's a reason that we get no grants and no grant applications to any private companies, or because it's out of his comfort zone.
It's not his job to go find grants. It's his job to account for the grants. It is the curriculum directors.
The numbers of the grants,
It's the curriculum directors. It's the principals. It's everyone else that should be seeking the grants. It's his job to account for the grants and know how to account for the grants for federal legislation, state legislation, and how to report them correctly.
I've met the guy. I like him. I know he's well-liked. I don't have any him personally, but... there are positions on this that if you look and if you compare with other organizations, we overpay. Just saying, and that we should look at this. It's fair to look at the people that are underpaid,
mm-hmm.
and it's also fair to look at the people that have become structurally overpaid.
Okay. But I do want to point out that there is longevity involved in some of these people, that, and they have been here for over 20 years. So, and maybe their titles are need to be updated.
It's not always a good thing. Mm-hmm. Every position.
Yeah, but what do? Fire someone because they've been here too long?
I think you might have a lawsuit if you did that.
You can. These are at-will employees that can be hired or fired for any reason at all, or no reason.
That's true, but if somebody's doing a good job and they continue to stay for 20 plus years, I would think that institutional memory is a good thing.
If you look at the area of grants in particular, that is one that they tell organizations to cycle those positions, that you get new contacts, new information, and that...
But he's not writing grants.
He's not the grant writer.
And it's probably
he's just
title.
Crunching the numbers
he's
on the grant.
I call him the grant accountant. He does all the special revenue funds.
Then that's the name rather than grant bookkeeper.
Right. Well, that's my fault, because I do want them to be... I don't want them to be referred to as bookkeeper, because they all are accountants.
Okay. But anyway, everyone else is a 2% except for Scott Paul. You're not voting on anything tonight. You're voting in June.
Okay.
Because the request came a couple of years ago that we would just bring this to you in June and you would have no opportunity to absorb or discuss the information.
Okay.
So
he's doing a fine job, though.
He's doing a great
job. He is doing a great job.
And inherited a mess.
Yeah.
And he inherited
Boy, did he ever.
So.
And being an IT, a director-level person in IT, is still... a value.
Yes.
Even
yes,
after
it is.
The 5%.
Yes. Yes, I know that. And people take jobs with school systems for other reasons than just getting wealthy, and I accept that. But I think he should be in line with other school systems, and that's what my attempt is.
I agree.
Is to make sure that our central office, our administrative team, are in line with other school systems.
Does he work through the summer?
Oh, yeah, he's a full year employee.
Yeah. They do a lot of stuff over the summer.
Yeah, they do a ton of stuff over the summer. So that's all on my point for that.
Okay, is that it for you, Patty?
Yes.
Okay. So back to reports. Collaborative did not have a meeting, but we're working on the executive director's evaluation. Marty, do you have input on that too?
On the evaluation, yes, I've already completed my evaluation. So
I'll be doing mine later tonight.
Yeah. Yeah. Get the cold start.
Yes, you do.
What's about the collective doing a marketing campaign for public ed?
The collaborative?
The collaborative doing a marketing campaign for public ed.
Oh, yeah, they're very involved in that.
I mean, I love that idea. That is sorely needed.
Yeah.
That, I will tell you, came out of the rural consortium meeting.
Yeah.
That, because there's so much money being spent by charter schools, and we're doing very little to advocate, not for a particular school, but for public education in general,
right,
locally. So that's what they're kind of spearheading. And I
which,
think it's a great
which
idea.
Brings me, I mean, our town meeting is coming up on Monday, and I know it's just a sort of a segue to this, but... it's going to be a, you know, the town, all indications are it's going to be a pretty copacetic meeting.
You had a pre-meet today, right?
We did have a pre-meet, and maybe, I don't know if Jan's going to that. Maybe that's where she's at.
I don't know if Jan went to the pre-meet.
No, she had,
she had a family thing.
Oh, okay.
Right. There were a lot of cars there, though.
Well, because we say the budget here was modest enough that the town's buying themselves a fire truck, too. which... So
Judy could have used that fire.
Right.
Make sure you use the fire truck.
But basically that you have a lightning rod, a controversy, whatever, and
right.
So the anticipation would be that this would be passed. But
will my homeowners go down then?
But I just wanted to let you know that I still wanted to ask. I still intend to stand up and ask for you to speak to the group, and I'm going to ask for you to speak to the meeting. Just because, because
what would you have me say?
Farewell, I love you.
Do the Obama thing?
Yeah, exactly. That's it.
Cicely, I don't,
because you'll have a microphone. Judy, that's it. This is your chance. Do the Obama thing at town meeting. Please do it. Oh, that would be wonderful. But
I don't think the sound people are going to appreciate.
No, that would be so fantastic to stand there and say, Ceciliato, up, drop the microphone. Up.
I'll do it.
But you know, just for a minute, just to say how much you've enjoyed your
did my TV thing again this year.
I know. But just to give a spiel about
how
great the school is, and send your kid, this is the town meeting, aside from everything else, is your greatest exposure to the greatest number of parents and community members. Mm-hmm. And I like to hear somebody say,
it's marketing.
To market.
And okay.
Bring your kid. It's great school. Send your kid.
Yeah. I did get a chance to do that at Sunderland the other night, to tell them that they had to add money to their budget because there's so few kids going out in charter and choice that they had to add money to the local budget or they wouldn't admit net school spending. So they didn't like the 10% increase in our budget, but they liked the message, I think, that our kids are coming to Sunderland Public Schools.
That's great.
Marty, we could do, I think it's the sound, from the Sound of Music, goodbye, farewell.
Goodbye, farewell, Avita.
Why am I doing that over on TV?
Don't give it away.
Don't give it away. Cut that part.
We could do that. We could, Terry. We need more than two of us. We have to do all the parts. we could walk out that way.
Yeah.
And then we could just leave.
and the fellow that always complains that we leave after the budget, he could stand up and say, see, even now they're doing it.
He always votes no for the budget anyway, and then complains that you leave right after the vote.
Judy, I'm going to hold you to this.
Great.
What do we have to lose? We're not getting new furniture. We're not
Excellent. All right.
Our budgets will have been passed by after the budgets are passed, not before.
Okay.
Arrange it, Phil. All right. Principal's report.
Oh, boy.
I signed them all, Brandon.
Did you really?
You did.
I haven't gotten them yet.
Okay. We'll pass them on to you then.
Phil. I like your...
He did sign it.
Is that, it's working its way down? Are you next, Kurt?
No.
No?
I'm just growing my hair long. I'm just growing my hair short.
Good morning.
No white patches for you yet.
From June.
Okay, thank you, dear. Oh, do you need a cup? I need another cup.
I thought it was more than one paper, so...
Oh, I thought it was two. Okay.
Can you please give our old principal your attention?
Yeah. She even slammed. She's close.
Building and grounds and furniture. No, building and grounds. During the April break, Bruce did repair a number of those overhead light fixtures in the gym. They're not so much the light itself, but the fixture portion can sometimes be hit by basketballs and whatever else is in there. So he fixed those. And I just wanted to, once again, really note the Frontier custodians, if we call them and ask for whatever we ask for, they're more than accommodating. So I just wanted to give a little shout out to them. I think the hallway carpet was also shampooed right before mud season. I talked to Bruce about power washing the fence. There's a fence on the right-hand side of the road, the driveway leading to the back of the building, which has really become pretty unsightly. So that's a project that will be done probably in the next couple of weeks or so. He and I are also creating a list of sort of tentative projects that probably need to be done around the school, just so that when the new principal comes on board, she can have that list and whatever she wants with it.
Not necessarily the young principal, but the new
young principal.
I never said old,
really. I think it started with the paying me for them. Right downhill from them. We had May Day today. It's sort of an annual, annual event. Did you come?
No, I usually do come.
So lots of people really work behind the scenes to make this happen. A lot of parent volunteers. Katrina Neal is always helpful. Arlene teaches the dance, the dances to the children and to the staff. So they always begin from the far end of the building, and the Morris dancers lead all the classes one by one down today to the gym because of the weather. And when they get to the gym, there's a lot of singing, dancing. The sixth grade does two special dances since they're graduating. The staff does the same dance every year, and they have it down now. And then we have 8 years. It's actually wonderful, a wonderful event, and PTO provides ice cream for the kids. So a big thank you to all who make that possible, especially teachers and students. Teachers have to take a little time off out of the day to go over the songs and so forth. The Academy of Charlemont has a newly formed course that Katrina Neal is developing. So they came and performed for us April 25th. It also, the course includes three graduates from Conway. So it's a combination of some proselytizing
recruiting
and an opportunity to sort of acknowledge our kids who are singing. Our own kids loved it. It was actually really very, very entertaining.
Seriously.
The little proselytizing, what can you do? We try to keep them at bay as much as possible. April 27th, Frontier students gave a wonderful panel presentation to our fifth and sixth graders discussing digital devices, particularly iPhones. Fifth and sixth graders were riveted and asked some really good questions. The kids from Frontier were very, very informed, answered the questions carefully, and gave a number of little suggestions to the children. One that I thought could be really helpful. One Frontier student said, you know, if I'm on my iPhone for more than 25, 30 minutes, it beeps and I stop and I actually take a 10-minute break rather than just keep going and going and going. And I was sort of looking at our fifth and sixth graders who you could see were registering, that might not be a bad thing to do. So they gave a number of suggestions to our kids. They were very good.
This was just to jump in, organized by Maureen Belchi, and was throughout the district. I heard wonderful feedback. And when I spoke to her today, the plan is to continue this next year because the peer-to-peer influence was really impressive.
This is an area, it's amazing to me, just how difficult it is for a young person to be a good digital citizen and to make good decisions, consistently good decisions in this area. There are so, this is a really complicated area, really complicated.
It is complicated.
Annually, this would be great. So,
I'm glad that she's going to do that.
And each of the students kept coming back to the safety aspect, and that when they're in doubt, they go immediately to their parents. And that was very impressive for our kids.
That changes. That changes in a year or two.
I should wait.
She's still up. Don't undo. We had our school show on the 14th, always well attended.
That was great.
It was really good. I liked it. The theme was immigration and the contributions that immigrants have made to the country. So a thank you to Janet. There's a school show committee made up of teachers who also help formulate what's actually going to happen, teachers and students, and especially to acknowledge the sixth graders and Rick Gifford who work with them to put on a number of skits about immigrants. And also Jody Massa and the after school kids who did all the scenery, very beautiful sets. The sixth grade versus the faculty basketball. It was lots of fun this year. Sixth grade, barely we dealt it.
That was high scoring.
A win over the ever forceful staff. Always at the in the last 4 minutes they win.
Yeah.
I don't know how that happens every year. So from the oldest to the youngest, there are 20 kindergartners registered for next year.
That's a good number.
I think all but two are, actually all but one are homegrown. We have one mm-hmm. choice because a sibling is also at our school. So that's a little bit of an uptick for us in terms of kindergarten. Yeah, we had been going down like to 15, 16, but now we're back up to 20, which is pretty good. The 5K, this should be fun, not run. Should be fun, walk, run.
Oh,
sorry. It's scheduled for May 22nd, beginning at 9 a.m. from the center of town. All participants receive T-shirts. The funding for the shirts, it's a combination of donations and local businesses, and also a nice grant that the committee got from Tufts University. Grant was for $500 for an organization at Tufts called the Billion Mile Race Foundation. So everyone gets a T-shirt, and the logos of the local businesses are on the back of the T-shirt. I just want also to let you know that all of this, sort of the once a week walking or running that the kids are doing on Tuesdays to, I think they have over 500 miles now, really all of that is planned and executed by this committee. It's Paulette, Lepcha, Jen Wheeler, Joe Sirmuddy, Jill, Maggie West, Jill Barnes, Maggie West, and Meg really do a lot of work. They meet once every 2 or 3 weeks early in the morning and have planned all these events. And they hope that the 5K fun walk run will be an annual event. Mm-hmm. So we have lots of families signed up for that, kind of families. Mm-hmm. Many staff people will be well represented. So it's a nice idea.
Who organized the trail making committee?
Making
that was really
that was
fun
wonderful.
Too. And that trail came together and like, have you walked it yet?
No,
it's
I haven't.
It's really cool.
Is it the one around the school?
Megan Gump.
No, it goes in the woods behind the school.
Oh. Are there ticks in there?
They stomped them down. We raked them up.
I don't go and take care of it.
A lot of folks showed up for that.
It was really
cool. It
was
real cool inspiring.
How
yeah.
fast it came together with all those. And
it's
yeah.
It's a nice trail.
They actually
is it?
Yep.
Emailed a digital map of it.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. Hmm. I just got it today.
That's awesome. That was fun. Marty, you're up.
Yeah, I handed out to you my report. You wanted to highlight again the Rural Consortium of Superintendents. We continue to meet. We're meeting again next week, May 9th. We have made the following recommendations. In fact, I had sent a letter to our local legislators with these 4 points that we were supporting. This one was on the Whately School Committee had asked me to do that on behalf of their school committee. We had suggested that districts only be responsible for $5,000 and we would spend that amount to the charter school, and the difference in the per pupil cost would be assumed by the state. Rather than getting charged the $1,850 or $20,000 or whatever the charter schools are coming up with. Charters must first consult with a local superintendent to discuss any actual need for a charter prior to a charter being actually established. Charter schools must have local representation to serve on its board of directors, and increased oversight on charter enrollment, financial impact, and student retention rates. None of these things are currently occurring, so we're asking.
Even if they're implemented, would any of them affect? I mean, the things that I saw, the making charters talk to the superintendent of the sendings, mm-hmm. the language that they use is things like so that would be, you know, that would be Greenfield or South Hadley or whatever. That still wouldn't be.
No, it would be it prior to the establishment of a charter school. in the area that you want to establish it in, come talk to the superintendents of that area to find out what is it that you're providing.
That we're not.
That, yeah. How
prove that you have a charter, a viable charter that isn't just academic in nature like the public schools provide.
But none of that has occurred, and I did just learn that Representative Baez and Senator Chang Diaz, who were both on the Education Committee, said that despite everyone's efforts, it's unlikely that the Senate and House will bother with charter school legislation this year. So, and also what I had told Waitley earlier was one of the things that I am starting to see is a break off in the language. They're referring more to charter schools in the urban areas as the urban charter school discussion. So I don't know if that's good or bad, so stay tuned.
Bad.
Could be. April, as you know, was spent discussing the defending budgets. We've had three town meetings. Our final one is next week for Conway. The Frontier budget is approved because we've had three of the four as part of our regional agreement. And I'm very pleased the principals have been very aggressive. I don't know that Judy's had too many hires for next year that you've had to do, but district-wide, because of so many retirements, they've been hiring some really fine people, have had some terrific applicants. So I'm pleased with the language that I'm seeing from the applicants, you know, desirable district and the number of applications. I think for one first grade position here in Waitley, we got 108 applications.
Oh my God.
So we're getting lots and lots of applications. So I'm pleased about that.
What does that say?
We're desirable.
We're a desirable district to be in. Now, that includes all the ones we get through school spring and, you know, so, but your elementary classroom positions, you see a lot of, you see a lot of that.
You get into Jance?
So that's all I have.
Great. Can I get a motion to adjourn?
Motion.
Motion.
Second.
8:02.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.